Hi, this is Eric Martin, Report Game Geek. I am joined by Ronja Lauterbach from Pegasus Spiele. Ronja, great to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So on the table, we have Stefan Feld's Bonfire. This is a co-publication between Hall Games and Pegasus, with Hall Games' Ralph Brun doing the development, and I guess Pegasus running with the production and distribution. This is a massive game with tons of stuff going on in here. I don't know if you want to give a high-level overview, and then we can get into more detail.
Yeah, sure. Let me just lay the scene, because there's actually a lot of story behind this game. So Bonfire is set in a world which is called Asperia, and it's orbiting a small sun, which is so weak that there's actually no life possible on this planet because it's only a little bit of gloomy light every day. But then someday, and nobody knows why, the Guardians of Light appeared, and they created magical orbs of light called bonfires, and they made it possible for life to develop on this planet. And unbeknownst to the Guardians, intelligent life came into existence, and they are called the Shadow Folk, or gnomes by the Guardians. And because they didn't know that they created intelligent life, they felt the need to actually do this on purpose once more. And they created the Ancients, who were very beautiful and skilled and everything, and so much superior to the gnomes. And at first, the Guardians were very happy. But then the Ancients became discontent, and they wanted to be the ones in charge of the bonfires. And there was a conflict between the Guardians and the Ancients, which led to the Guardians retreating to their islands, which is where they start at the beginning of the game. And the Ancients actually dying out, and all the bonfires going out. But because, of course, the Guardians remembered that the gnomes were also living on this planet, they thought, give the little guys a chance. Maybe they can save the world if they can show us that they're worthy of this knowledge to take care of the bonfires. And this is what the players are trying to do. They are the leaders of one of the gnome tribes, and they have two complete different tasks to bring back the Guardians and reignite the bonfires in the cities. And so what you're doing in this game is actually always only one of three options. So the first option is you can get new action tiles, which you do by taking one of the fate tiles next to your player board and adding it to the field of fate in the middle of your player board. And you can only do this if you only have one action tile left, or no action tile, actually. And you can orient them to match the tokens that are already there. And from the tile that you place, you get new action tiles. And if you don't get new action tiles, you will spend these action tiles to do various actions, which I will go to in a moment. And the third option you have is to ignite one of the bonfires you have tried to build. So these are the three basic options: either get more actions, use action tiles, or ignite a bonfire. So for the actions, there's a lot of stuff you can do. You can spend an action tile, for example, to use your boat to go through the different islands. And there are two types of islands. There are islands where you can collect tasks, and these will turn into bonfires. And there are islands with guardians on them, and you try to bring these guardians back to your city. Whenever you collect a guardian, they will go to the left space on your player board. You already start with one guardian of your player color, and you can get a total of five guardians. With the tasks, you have to pay the corresponding action tile, of course, and you also have to pay resources, which are depicted on the island and also on the token you put in place of the tasks you pick up from that island. So on your player board, where the field tokens are, there are also at the top and the bottom markers which show which resource you have to spend to place this on an island and exchange it for one of the tasks there. If you take a task, you will put it on one of the bonfire spaces on your board. And at a later turn, you can use your turn to ignite this if you completed the task. Then you can get cards, which are elders or specialists, which are the elders are the blue, the yellow cards at one side, And the specialists are the blue cards on the other side. There are only 6 elders, so if they're gone, they're gone forever. But the specialists, there's a deck of them, and they can be refilled, and they will give you special bonus actions. So, for example, you can do some actions better or lose some restrictions. Yeah, thanks. So, for example, with this one, you can have multiple guardians in the same space, which usually you would not be allowed to. So every guardian would have to be on a different space. But yeah, so every specialist is individual and there's only one of them each. And while the elders, they will give you victory points when you get them. Another action you can take is, yeah, so this would be points for cards you have. Yeah, one point for each specialist or elder. One action would be to go to the central bonfire in the middle, and you can turn this and pick up either resources or these little portal tokens, which you need to connect the bonfire with the way of the guardians. And you can extend with another action the way these guardians have. So you will pick up one of these way tiles, which are at the bottom of the central field right now. These exactly, and you can add them to your path. And this is where the guardians will walk to reach the bonfires. But as I said, they can only reach the bonfires if there's a portal that matches. And also the bonfire has already has to be ignited already to allow for a guardian to go there. So you have to figure out the best combinations of turns depending on the actions you get from the Fields of Fate to get the guardians, fulfill the tasks, continue the route the guardians can walk on and so forth. And the beautiful thing here is that there's not one way to do this. So every player will have a different strategy for their game and they will all be pretty well balanced. For example, in the first game I played, I concentrated on doing simple tasks and completing the way for the guardians, while my partner, my opponent, he was more focused on getting specialists and to get the more expensive tasks, but do fewer of them. And we were matched to the point, so we actually needed a tiebreaker to determine who the winner was, even though our strategies were completely different from each other. Right. So this is really great, I think, if a game allows you to have a different strategy and still be completely in balance with the rest of the players. So yeah, the game ends when there are, this might be important. The game is when there's a certain amount of gnomes in the council, which is around the central bonfire, and you will always send one of these of your own gnomes when you ignite a bonfire. And there are also gnomes which do not belong to any player, but they are in the central area already. And you can place them in the council when you complete their task. And depending on the player count, there's a different number, how many gnomes there must be in the council to trigger the end game. Then there are 5 more turns for every one. And then there's a huge scoring in the end. So you can already collect points during the game, but most of them you will receive at the end in the final scoring.
Right. All right. Wow. That was super succinct. You've done this a few times.
That's my job.
So, yes. So maybe to give more examples, if we can look at some of the task tiles on the islands that will sort of give you indications of the challenges that you would face or trying to do things.
Lincoln can again get them closer and I can tell you what the things are.
Yeah, because the tasks come in 3 different types, 3 different levels of difficulty. Yes. So of course, as you said, there are the easier and harder ones that are worth different number of points depending on the challenge.
Yeah.
And that's all color coded.
Okay, so the blue one, for example, for 2 points, you need to have a way tile in your path which shows the leaf resource. So that's easy to do because you just pick up one of the tiles and place it in your path at some point, and that's easy. Then for 5 points,
assuming one shows up,
the top right, you need to have all the guardians from the islands. So this is much harder to do. Or for the one below that, you need to have bonfire ignited in each color. And so each of these tasks is either blue, yellow, or pink. And on the back, there will be a blue, yellow, or pink bonfire as well. Then you need to have three action tiles for which you could usually use for the great bonfire. It's actually the blue one for 3 points, which is not easy to do, actually, even though it's an easy task from the color, because you get the tiles from, as I said, placing them on the fields of fate to match symbols. And the more you match up, the more action tiles you get. But three of the same kind is kind of rare. Usually,
that's right.
There are also tasks where you have to have a certain layout of action symbols on your field of fate. So maybe three brown and three green symbols connected on your field of fate, and that's even harder to do, especially if you pick that task up somewhere in the middle of the game when you haven't planned for that kind of constellation on your field of fate area.
Those are different things
you can try to do. I'm not sure. I think one of them has to do with ships, but I can't quite make it out here.
They're all very different.
And in the first game, you usually have different colors on each island. So there will be one yellow, one red, one pink task on each island. But in later games, when you already experienced, then you can just do this randomly, and then you may have three or two tasks in the same color, and maybe the blue ones are all the way in the back and only the difficult tasks in the beginning. So this can influence the game a lot, of course.
Right. So you make it sounds very straightforward when you say there's only three actions possible on a turn, but it gets in way more involved in that very quickly, because of course you place your, I forget what they call them, your own personal tiles onto your board to give you a supply of action tiles. And that gives you some idea of what you can do in the future turns, because there are six types of action tiles and each action is associated with different things. It's very challenging to try to wend a path through all of that.
Yes. Well, the thing is, it's the core is not the tricky part. The tricky part is the interconnection between the different actions and what you do with them and when you do them. That's the part where you really have to put your thinking cap on and think, okay, I got this and I can do this next. You can already see while you do your actions which tiles you will get next and think about how to use them later on. So maybe you can already see that the next tokens you can place would be for sailing. So maybe you want to go ahead and plan which path to go with your ship on. And then depending on that, you will do some actions right now. So there's a lot of interconnection you really have to think about. That's what makes this a complex game. It's not so much the basic concept.
Because you have the sailing, but you also need to pair it with an offering tile or a guardian tile, depending on whether you're going to get new tasks or get a guardian. But guardian tiles are also needed in order to move them on your way path. So, yes, deciding what to spend there. The game does have a nice correction, I guess, if you have issues in that any two tiles can be a tile of your choice and any two resources can also be a resource of your choice. So when in doubt, just get lots of stuff if possible.
Exactly. That's always helpful. There are also some specialists who can really help you with this. So for example, there's a specialist whenever you get a specialist, you get a gold or something like that. So these can help you a lot. Or there's a specialist who allows you to use one of the Joker action tiles. There are as two action tiles and stuff like that. So the specialists can be really, really powerful. But of course, when you use them, you lose the opportunity to maybe spend these resources you had to go through the islands and take the tasks from there. So Can't do everything.
No. I don't know if it's possible to put one of the player boards on the green screen, Lincoln. One of the, the semicircle. No, the semicircle space. Yeah. Just to get more of a close-up look there. I know there's a lot of stuff balanced on there.
Okay. Lincoln, can you also grab one of the tiles with the three action slots from the... Yes. So one of the actions would be to maybe place this, and maybe you want to orient it so that the guardians are matching exactly. So if you do this, you would get one action to go to the bonfire, one action to pick up a task, and two actions to either move the guardians or recruit guardians and bring them to your city. So that's also something you have to think about, how to orient this. You could also do this from top to bottom. So you could turn it around 90 degrees and put it at the end. Whenever you cover up one of the gold coins, you will get the gold resource, which is a joker. And whenever you cover up one of the question mark icons, you get a joker task, a joker action tile, which you can use for whichever action you like. So placing these is also important, because when you fill up the space somewhere, maybe you can't put another of these tokens somewhere you would get an extra resource, for example, because there's not enough space left.
Right.
So yeah, and there's also above it, the at the edge of the semicircle, there are the spaces for the bonfires, and when you put a task there and complete it, you turn it around and you will send the gnome that stands next to that bonfire to the council, and they will also give you an immediate bonus, and they will also give you points.
Okay. There's one additional complication. I see Lincoln has the little portal tile in there, and it's actually, as you're building a path, the path is built from left to right, and the portals have to be filled in from right to left. So
yes,
it's a nice challenge where you could have an extremely short...
But of course, there's also a specialist for that who allows you to place the portals in any order you like. So that might be something to look out for and try to get, so you don't have that difficulty to get the portals all the way to where the guardians are.
Right.
Or you just have to move the guardians a lot to get them to the other end.
Yeah, it gives you flexibility for what you're trying to do. Either maybe you're focusing on the path and you have very few portals, but it's worth far more if you do get the guardians over to those bonfires on the end. Or you end up with lots of portals and not much path, or a mix of both.
Exactly. Or a mix of both, yes.
Yeah, it definitely changes a lot. Because you mentioned the neutral gnomes, the gnomes in the center of the board that are not connected to anything, but you get one of those, for example, if you get all of the portals, or you complete all of your path. So you have additional incentives.
Definitely.
To do that.
But at some point you have to start focusing on what you want to accomplish, really. In there are other expert games where you have to be good at everything. That's not something I think you can really do here, but at some time you have to prioritize and say, okay, so this is what I want to accomplish by the end of the game, and maybe not focus on something else instead.
Definitely. But I mean, it does give you, it's very Feldian, like having that bonus to sort of pull you along, or at least give you some idea that if I don't know what else to do, here are some things I can focus on. Although, of course, you're focusing on your task as well, for what you're trying to do.
I think the good thing here is that you don't really get punished for not doing something, but you always get rewarded for doing something else. So there's always a good feeling about what you're doing, even though you're not doing something else in that moment.
That's a good way to think of it. Yes. Okay. Got questions. So the game is out now. I think you mentioned in September. Came out in Germany.
Yes, it came out at the end of September in Germany. The game is on its way to the US as we speak, and it should arrive in November sometime. If nothing goes horribly wrong with the ship.
I've heard
icebergs, I hope.
Yes, I've heard this year.
It's on its way, and it should be there in November.
Okay, I've heard this year every delivered game is a miracle. So I don't know if that's true from your experience so far, but
it's been a bit tricky this year, definitely.
Yes.
If that's something that's interesting for you, because I really like this, because usually in a Stefan Feld game you don't have a lot of theme, but with this one the illustrator actually came up with the whole background story and he actually wrote it. So we have this little booklet, which is like 16 pages, and it tells you how things happened on this planet. Some, like a bit of this I talked about in the beginning, and you can actually download this from our website and read it. I translated it myself, and my American colleague Joanna did some proofreading, so the English is not terrible. Okay. So yeah, you can check that out on our website and just find out what happened on Asperia in detail. And then get to play the game and save the world.
I did not remember all of those details from the rule book when you were giving the backstory. I'm like, where was this? Where did this all come from?
Where was that? Yeah.
Yes. So anything else to mention about Bonfire? We have a few more minutes, or I don't know if you want to talk about other titles from Pegasus.
Well, maybe just to mention, we do have Tabletopia demo rounds for this during Spiel Digital. In German and in English. So if you want to give it a go on Tabletopia, you can. You can also play on Tabletopia without someone from Pegasus Spiele if you want. So if you don't feel like waiting until the ship arrives, you can try it on your computer. But it's really better on the table.
Right.
And the other thing maybe to say is that I already mentioned this earlier, but now I know more details. We also have a live stream which will start about now, actually, in English, and we will have different panels there, for example, with John New from Talisman Island and from James Wallace, who was the designer of former fantasy roleplay, and Lou Crane from Kickstarter, and John Kovalit, who is the illustrator for Munchkin, but also for our new game, Doodle Dungeon, which will hopefully come out in the beginning of 2021. And I'm immensely excited about, because it's a really, really cool dungeon drawing hero dying game.
That's right. I remember you had only a mock-up box, I think, in Spielwarenmesse. So yeah.
Yeah, it was very, very alpha in Nuremberg, but it's done now and it's in production and we'll get there.
Okay. So how did Bonfire get to be on Tabletopia? Was that planned to begin with, or is that a response to what has happened this year in terms of trying to make the game available?
It's definitely a response to what happened this year. So when Corona hit Germany, we tried to come up with ways to keep our players involved. And so we started an online convention called Conspiracy, and we actually have the fourth one of that in November. And so at the beginning, we only had role-playing rounds there for Cthulhu and Shadowrun. But we, of course, we also wanted to get the board gamers involved as well. And so for our third Conspiracy, we integrated more board games. And one of them was Bonfire, which we actually pre-launched digitally on Conspiracy 3. So okay. We have multiple games on Tabletopia now just to keep players busy and happy. And hopefully next year, everything will be better again.
Okay. Well, does that mean, was it successful? Like, what sort of feedback are you trying to get from introducing it digitally? Does that lead to things down the road? I don't know if you're surveying users or seeing if it's something you would want to continue in the future, or is it just like, this is a one-off and then we're done?
It's hard to say right now, but from the get-go, like from the day we put it in stores, the game has been doing extremely well. I don't know if that's due to the fact that it's Stefan Feld on the box, or if that's due to the fact that they had already 2 months to play it online. But I'd like to think, of course, that the Conspiracy and the possibility to play it ahead of its release has something to do with it. And so actually, yeah, we got feedback from people who wouldn't really go to conventions except for like Spiel, but they would play at home on weekends. And so for them, this is a great way to do it on Tabletopia. And I think we have more than 2,000 registered users on our Discord channel for Conspiracy. So people keep coming back to play more games and talk with us. And that's really nice.
All right. Well, that sounds really good. Yeah, it's hard to know from data points of like two, you know, and make judgments what to do in the future. Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Ronja, for joining us, giving us an overview of Steffenfeld's Bonfire, out now in Europe and coming out November-ish 2020 for the US. Thank you very much.
Again, thank you for having me, and have a good rest of the show.